take your seat. The program is about to begin.
Good afternoon, everyone. Once again, here's your host, Barb Baker.
Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome back for the Innovation, Entrepreneurship, and Impact panel presented by RISE. This panel provides an opportunity for ISEF attendees to hear from successful ISEF alumni about their careers, creating startups, launching innovations, and making a difference around the world. For those of you presenting your questions to the panel today, please step to the microphone in the center aisle when prompted. And we have a special treat for you. Some of this afternoon's panelists will be available in Hall B and C for a brief selfie session immediately following this session. We invite you to stop by and say hello. Before we begin, I'm pleased to introduce two very special guests joining us from RISE. Welcome analyst Olivia Randall and senior program specialist Charmaine Lee.
Hey everyone, we are so happy to be here today and represent RISE, an initiative of Schmidt Futures and the Rhodes Trust. We're proud to sponsor today's 2022 Innovation, Entrepreneurship and Impact Panel. If you're interested in learning more about RISE, sign up using the QR code found on the flyer you received today.
We are grateful for the chance to begin this wonderful discussion with some words from the RISE Executive Director, Mark German. While he would have loved to be here with you all today, he has a video message he wanted to share with you.
Thank you. Enjoy the discussion, and over to Mark.
Hello, my name is Mark German, and I am the Executive Director of RISE, an initiative of Schmidt Futures and the Rhodes Trust. Welcome to the 2022 ISEF Innovation, Entrepreneurship, and Impact Panel. Thank you to the Regeneron ISEF team for having us here today. In line with the spirit of this panel, our co-founders, Eric and Wendy Schmidt, believe in the power of finding the next generation of brilliant innovators and entrepreneurs who are committed to serving others and making a positive social impact throughout their lives. Through the RISE program, one key way we accomplish this is through our RISE Challenge, where 15 to 17-year-olds can apply by submitting a project about the kind of positive change they want to make happen in the world. Our inaugural cohort of 100 global winners, hailing from 42 countries and speaking 21 languages, receive a lifetime of benefits depending upon need, including scholarships, internships, career support, access to a global network, a three-week residential summit in South Africa, and more. RISE became a partner with Society for Science and ISEF because we believe young people like those of you in the room or that you should engage with would be ideal RISE candidates. Well, we were right. We have had a number of RISE global winners from the ISEF community and even a few who are competing as ISEF finalists this year. RISE has benefits for everyone in our community. Each applicant joins a global community of leaders and gains access to free online courses and opportunities from our partners around the world. I hope that you're inspired by the panel today and by the entire program this week at ISEF. We also hope that you walk away confident in your ability to use your talents and innovative mindset to make a positive impact in your community and around the world. And we hope that some of you will consider applying to RISE or telling others about the program. Thank you to the organizers, the applicants, and the educators and mentors who support them. And good luck to all of the ISEF finalists.
Our thanks to RISE for presenting this event. Now please welcome back to the stage, President and CEO of Society for Science and publisher of Science News, Maya Esmera.
Thanks, Barb, and welcome everyone. Today, you will learn that innovation doesn't stop at Regeneron ISEF. In fact, many of you are just at the beginning of a tremendous journey of scientific discovery and entrepreneurship. I am certain you will receive excellent advice and wisdom that I hope will inspire you to continue down this STEM path. Remember, not too many years ago, the people on this panel were finalists here, just like you. They competed, they made friends and connections, and many are still in touch through our alumni network. You will learn today that not only are our alumni launching companies and disrupting industries, they are also seeking to improve the world. Each of our panelists today is looking to scale products and ideas so that it will positively impact humanity and our planet. So let's get started. I am thrilled to introduce George Chen. George is an alum of ISEF 2006 and attended Monta Vista High School in California. Today, he is an assistant professor of information systems at Carnegie Mellon University, where he works on trustworthy machine learning, mostly applied to healthcare. George also co-founded and now advises for Cool Crop, an Indian agri-tech company that provides rural farmers with cold storage hardware and market forecasts. George completed his undergraduate at Cal Berkeley and master's degree and PhD in electrical engineering and computer science at MIT. Let's give him a round of applause. I'm now pleased to introduce Uliana Sudzisky-Pena, who competed at ISEF in 2000, 2001, 2002, and 2003. She is a graduate of Padua Franciscan High School in Ohio. She is a scientist, mountaineer, educator. She started the citizen science company, Science in the Wild, focused on creating immersive and educational adventure science expeditions for the lay public. Uliana is a visiting assistant professor at Colorado College and an associate scientist with North Central Climate Adaptation Center at the University of Colorado, Boulder. She obtained her undergraduate degree in geology from Rice University, her master's degree in planetary geology from Brown University, and her PhD in geological sciences from the University of Colorado, Boulder. Let's give her a round of applause. I'm now pleased to introduce Ashley Saraceno, who's an alum of the 1999 and 2000 ISEF and attended Grant High School in New Mexico. Since ISEF, Ashley has established herself as a Native American Indigenous consultant, leader, entrepreneur, and president of Native Ascension Community Development. Native Ascension is a Laguna Acoma Pueblo woman-owned business enterprise providing technical assistance to American Indian tribes, Native organizations, nonprofit organizations, and small rural businesses. Ashley also founded the nonprofit My Native Sisters Fire to advance her work on Native Indigenous women and girls empowerment. Ashley obtained her BA in cultural anthropology and her MA in education from Stanford University. Let's give a round of applause to Ashley. I'm now pleased to introduce Matthew Tamayo Lejos, who competed in ISEF in 2002 while attending Langley High School in Virginia. He's the founder and CEO of Open Lattice, a data science company that empowers civil servants, researchers, and policymakers to work together on society's toughest challenges. Matthew has spent his career working at the intersection of data and computer security, including time at both Microsoft and Plantier, along with founding Open Lattice and another startup, Cryptognostic. He holds double degrees in mathematics and computer science from Rensselaer Polytechnic Institute, a master's in applied mathematics from the University of Washington, and has received three information security patents, as well as a patent for deep learning faith entity resolution. Let's give it for Matthew. And now I'm pleased to introduce Mo Zerben, who's an alum of the 2010 ISEF and went to the Alexandria House of English in Alexandria, Egypt. His career started by building the world's first modular biodigester for household usage with a more efficient protocol. He went on to found Chem Water and has been working on sustainable utility management for more than 10 years. Mo wants to accelerate the adoption of big data, smart technologies, and convenient services to how people utilize resources. Mo received his Bachelor of Mechanical Engineering from Drexel University. Let's give a round of applause to Mo. So to get started, tell us a little bit about your ISEF experience and the impact it had on you. I will start with Uliana.
So ISEF had an incredible impact on me because I started competing at age 14, and I competed throughout my high school career. And one of my favorite activities was the exchange of the pins, meeting students from all around the world, and learning how to communicate my science in easy ways to understand.
How about you, George?
I guess to add to what Uliana had said, for me anyways, where I grew up in Silicon Valley, and it was the high school I went to at that time, not a lot of people got involved in science fairs. So basically, I felt like I kind of lived and grew up in a bubble, and going to ISEF was very eye-opening, meeting people from so many different countries and meeting people who are all really excited about STEM. So that really had an impact in motivating me to pursue STEM in college.
Mo?
Community was top of line for me. I still, lots of the friends I met at ISEF, I still talk to do all the time right now. And it helped surround me with like-minded individuals that really helped accelerate my career.
Matthew.
Interested in science and really helped me get focused and pursue a career in science. And getting the positive feedback from people who shared similar interests, and also from the exhibitors and the feedback, from the judges that when exhibiting, was just an incredible experience.
Ashley.
So I grew up on a small Native American reservation in New Mexico, and I remember because my science fair teacher saw me as who I was, as a Native woman, he brought my culture into the classroom, and I immediately became obsessed with my science fair project. I remember going to school and then every day after school, Monday through Friday, going to work on my science fair project. And then lo and behold, all of the hard work from science fair paid off, and I was able to go to Detroit that year and meet all sorts of friends and build confidence, and then use all of my skills to go ahead and transform who I was as a woman, and then eventually was able to attend my dream university, which was Stanford University. So definitely a great experience at Science Fair.
So now a question from a virtual finalist, Uxuan Chen.
Hi everyone, I'm Yuxuan Chen from Hangzhou, Zhejiang, China. It's my privilege to ask my question here. My question for the panel is, where is technology leading us? The many science fiction we see human society destroyed or worsened because of technology. So what will the future be like? Will it be a better one in fiction, or a really ideal world for human beings in other spaces?
Thank you. Should I repeat the question, or you guys heard it? Guys heard it?
Yeah.
I think repeat it, please.
Okay. Where is technology leading us? In many science fictions, we see human society destroyed or worsened because of technology. So what will the future be like? Will it be cyberpunk, one in fictions, or a really ideal world for human beings and all other creatures? George.
I think a lot of this has to do with basically, a lot of this will be up to you. So I really think right now we don't have a lot of the answers to these sorts of questions. So for example, I work in machine learning, and I can easily say the technology for creating fake news is getting better and better.
and the ability to make like fake videos of whatever politician, whoever you want, saying whatever you want, that kind of technology is getting better. And it definitely is an open question to me. What are good ways for society to deal with this sort of technology? I'm not sure yet. It's hard to regulate. It's becoming increasingly hard to even just detect what's fake versus what's real. So hopefully, some of you will be able to help take society in a good direction rather than a negative direction for things like this.
Anyone else on the panel want to take that on?
Yeah, I love this question. It's a great question, and I think that to what George was saying, it's hard to predict, but I do think that the future is going to be highly decentralized. So that's why it's really based on individuals and what they do and how they act, because in a decentralized world, it really depends on us to make the future better.
Yeah.
All right. I think the human race is going to be an interplanetary species, and we're going to figure out so much cool stuff and solve a lot of our problems. I think every time throughout history, when people have sort of bet and been like, "Oh no, we're all going to run out of food. There's not going to be enough resources." Every single time, the ingenuity of scientists, like a lot of the people in this room, are what's been able to take us to the next level and overcome the challenges. And we've been, I think that I've heard this phrase, it's like the arc of the unit, like we've been on a better arc, and we've lived in times of, well, up until recently, unprecedented peace in both economic and scientific development. And I think it's up to you all to really continue that and take it into the future.
Okay. I have a question for Uliana. I suspect your career sounds like a dream to a lot of finalists out there. How did you make it a reality, and what choices or opportunities helped you get to where you are today?
Yeah, so ISEF, again, was kind of a launch pad for me. I realized that I really enjoyed travel, and I enjoyed communicating science. So everything, the choices that I made in college and beyond, were towards that goal. My freshman year in college, I found out there's an opportunity to potentially work on an icebreaker, a ship down in Antarctica. And so I persistently asked for it, and by senior year, I finally got the opportunity to work on board the ship. And that was the next phase. Now what can I do potentially in science with that experience? So being persistent has really paid off for what I really wanted to do, but having the skills to help me along that was also crucial.
Okay, so I'm going to ask if Pari Latwa of Texas can come up and ask her question.
Hello, I'm Pari Latwa, and I'm from Austin, Texas. Thank you so much for taking the time here and sharing your story with us. So my question was, how can entrepreneurship supplement scientific research? And how vital is entrepreneurship to furthering advancements in science? Thank you.
So who would like to take that question on?
I like this question too. I think that what got me into entrepreneurship personally was the desire to implement science on a larger scale. And I think I'm a big believer that there's more science than what's implemented at the moment. And if we can implement more solutions, the world will be a better place. So I think that's something that got me into entrepreneurship. And I always say that entrepreneurship is the research of people instead of the research of science. Mm. And you have to study investors, customers, so on and so forth. So you move on from just the central focus on science to the focus on people. And it's an exciting switch.
Ashley, I'll go. So I definitely believe in everything that Mo said, but I would go a little bit further and into the constraints that are within government when you go and work for somebody else. And so I believe that through entrepreneurship, you really have the opportunity to be completely innovative with no constraints. You have the ability to control your own destination and really you know, with your projects that you're working on here, you know, let's say some of you are on the verge of getting patents. If you have patents, entrepreneurship is really the way to go because there's no constraints and it sky's the limit so I definitely promote entrepreneurship.
Anyone else?
I guess just to add to the answers that have already been given, one other thing that's true for entrepreneurship and also just a lot of industry research, for example, is that starting a new company, like if you're, for example, I have co-founded a company in India, and it's an agri-tech company that helps provide rural farmers with refrigeration technology and also market forecasts. And part of this, we actually collect a lot of data. We collect data that otherwise you might not have gone and collected if you were just, you know, stuck in a university setting. So that's something that can help push research boundaries. And I will say, similarly in industry research, a lot of companies have access to the kind of data that you don't find in a university setting. So, I guess like obvious examples would be places like Facebook and Twitter collect tons of data on people, and the kinds of studies you can do with that data wouldn't be possible without what they're collecting.
Okay, I have a rapid fire question. Do you like being virtual or in person?
In person.
In person.
In person.
In person. 1,000% in person.
Wow. Wow. Very interesting. Very interesting. Okay, here's a question for you, Matthew. I understand you just sold your company. Congratulations.
Thank you.
I suspect the finalists are curious about what that process looks like. Can you tell us a little bit about it and if you have plans for what's next?
Sure. I would say I have a very sort of lucky process in the sense that we sort of reached the point where we had to make a decision of like, do we keep going further or do we find a home? And we got.
Is this open lattice?
This is open lattice.
Okay, got it. Okay.
Yeah. So in VC, I'm gonna just try to do VC parlance. So we didn't quite have product market fit, even though we had hit multiple millions in revenue. And so VCs expect like 3x year-over-year growth in order to like double down. And the go-to-market in the government space is usually a lot tougher because there's procurement rules and all these other things. So we ended up saying, hey, I think it's better if we find a home for the team and find a home for our customers so that the important work that we were doing for state and local governments could continue. So we got really lucky during that process, and we found someone who shared our values even though they weren't quite aligned in the same space. And that was really important for us, and so they actually worked with us to offboard our customers to either companies that are doing similar stuff or into like a separate entity that got spun out. And so that was super lucky. And I would say it's not always that smooth when you're going through an acquisition. Even though it was really smooth, it still took twice as long as we thought it would take. And it was still like a super like difficult negotiating process and everything. In terms of what's next, so I've been taking a lot of time now that I have some to look at the intersection of basically engineering, design, manufacturing, and simulation. And was actually having a conversation with Mo about this, about the challenges, because I was like, why don't we have an Iron Man-like thing, right? Why don't we have a Jarvis set where we can say, hey, run the simulation and get the result? And so one of the things I'm thinking about is what can we do to advance software in that space to advance this mission of sort of like improving engineering, design, and manufacturing.
Wonderful. Okay, let's hear from another virtual finalist, Heidi Hoke from Texas. Heidi.
Hi, I'm Heidi Hoke. I'm a freshman at Trans Mountain Early College High School in El Paso, Texas, United States. And the question I have for you today is, what was the biggest bump in the road that you had to face in life to get to the point where you are at now? For example, was it due to lack of family support or where you grew up in?
So let me state that question again. What was the biggest bump in the road that you had to face to get where you are today? For example, was one of them due to the lack of support or where you came from? who would like to take that on?
Yes.
Juliana.
So when I entered my PhD program, there wasn't any guaranteed funding for my project, and I really had my heart set on working in the Himalaya of Nepal, going to the glaciers, understanding how that landscape is changing in a changing climate. But there's no way to get there. We don't have any money, we don't have any grants. And so these are no longer in operation, but at the time, it was petridish.org and rockethub.com, and they were crowd fundraisers for science. You know how there's Kickstarter for projects. So that was one way that I was able to fund my first field expedition, get some of my data, and then apply for funding to continue on with the PhD. So again, it wasn't looking good at the beginning, my first year in the PhD, but again, finding these creative outlets, creative ways to do what you want to do.
One more. Anyone else want to take that on?
Yes, I can. So I'm Native American, as I mentioned earlier, and I grew up in a really small rural community, and I'm also a woman. And so oftentimes, you know, I would show up to meetings with, like, lots of men, and it would be very frustrating. And so, you know, similar to you all, you know, we have really bright minds, and we want to share our ideas, and oftentimes we get shut down. So what I learned was, you know, instead of expecting a chair at the table, I would bring my own chair and just continue to persevere with the support of my family and continue to use my mind and bring ideas and just never stop. And so just continue to always show up and never give up.
Wonderful. Here's a rapid question. Mo, waffles or pancakes?
Waffles.
Matthew?
Belgian waffles.
Waffles with whipped cream and strawberries.
Neither.
Neither. What?
I don't eat carbs, really.
All right.
Waffles.
Waffles. Very interesting. We heard from the president of Georgia Tech on Monday night that Waffle House is founded here in Atlanta by a Georgia Tech alum. So
really,
all of you should go to Waffle House if you haven't done that already. Here's a question for Mo. Mo, your passion is making our planet fully sustainable, and you're working towards that with your company, Turn. What technology, either yours or another, do you think has the greatest potential in creating a more sustainable world?
Nuclear energy.
What?
Nuclear energy. Nuclear energy, once it becomes safe, modular enough, and accessible, we're going to be living in a very different world, because everything we use right now and utilize revolves around energy prices. But once energy becomes abundant, then the whole world is going to shift dramatically. So my 10 to 20 year master plan, if you may, is to build a modular nuclear device, molten salt nuclear device that operates on nuclear waste and is accessible to people everywhere.
Wow. Okay, let's have a question from our panel, from our finalists. Hannah Hsu from California. Hannah.
Hi, everyone. My name is Hannah Hsu, and I'm from Carmel, California. How can we continue to encourage STEM research and learning in our areas? And what are some ways the government and local universities and programs are taking initiative to prepare the future generations with STEM education?
Who'd like to take that on? All right, I'm calling on you, George.
I think honestly a lot of universities do have outreach programs, and I think a lot of faculty members at universities do participate in various sorts of outreach programs. So I think it's one of those, like, I think these are important, and certainly for those who want to, you know, get involved in, learn more about STEM, seeing what their local, you know, college or university might offer in terms of opportunities could be helpful. I think I'll leave it at that.
Anybody else?
In high school, if something doesn't exist, then create it. You know, if there's some clubs that you can create, robotics, or things that interest you, is a really good step, because in science fairs and always felt pretty isolated, but then found out there are people who have interest, you know, in science as well, so let's maybe create a club and stimulate that interest. So that's one way at that local level. If it's not there, create it.
Anybody else? Okay. Here's a virtual question by Arkashna from Canada.
Hi, I'm Arkash from Canada. My question to the panelists is, on one end, we live in a world where the success of scientific innovation and entrepreneurship is narrowly dependent on the wealth it brings to investors in the short term versus the public good it acquires for society in the long term. On the other end, the most pressing issues in humanity are interracial and interspecies, like climate change and the loss of biodiversity. So how do we alter the impact valuation ecosystem to encourage youth initiatives that focus on acquiring public benefits rather than private profits?
Okay, let me state that question again. On one end, we live in a world where success of scientific innovations or entrepreneurship is narrowly determined by wealth it generates for investors in the short term versus public good it accumulates for the society in the long term. Yet the most pressing problems facing humanity are intergenerational and interspecies, such as climate change or biodiversity loss. How do we alter the impact valuation ecosystem that encourages and finances youth initiatives in a way that focuses on accruing public benefits rather than profits? Any thoughts around that? Yes, Mo?
Yeah, I think I raise a lot of capital, so I'm always talking to investors, and right now investors have been talking about using this term ESG, which is a term relating to sustainability, and investors have been investing a lot in sustainability recently. Investors invest in whatever customers want. So if customers want sustainability, they're going to invest in sustainability. And this is why I think entrepreneurship is more the research of people than the research of science. And if you're making products that are sustainable but also helpful to customers, you're gonna raise as much capital as you need.
Anybody else? Yes, Matthew.
Yeah, I would take that even one step further and say that investors aren't like, oh yeah, let's go burn a bunch of coal just because it'll make us more profits. In order to actually drive change, it has to start with like us as individuals. If everyone's basically making the cheapest choice possible, the investors will invest in companies that meet that demand. So in order to actually drive change, if you want to do it, I don't think it start. You can't just go and tell investors, hey, don't make money, because then they just won't invest. And so I think that there's probably a role for government to play in subsidizing and investing in technologies that may not have an immediate payoff. And then obviously there's like a role in like shaping consumer behaviors that have a part to play. So I don't think this is such a big question that I think it's like it's worth writing like a book or a blog post about like this. Like it's a huge question. A new cool thing recently is, I'll just finish with this, is I just saw a company recently that is making cellular foie gras, and they're literally growing foie from like duck cells, and it's basically way more efficient than, say, like raising an entire duck and putting it through the process. So there's already incredible stuff that's going to allow us to reduce animal suffering while still... I think innovation also has a very important role to play.
Anybody else? Ashley?
I will go. So I'm going to take it more to a grassroots level, and I'm involved in a lot of social change movements, and a lot of those movements are being led by you all. So I just want to say, like, what you're doing now is amazing. Continue to do what you're doing now. Continue to demand that it's people over profit. And just continue to share your ideas and be innovative with where your career and where your dreams are taking you. And if you ever, you know, need somebody to help or somebody to be in your corner, let us know, because we're definitely interested in supporting you.
Liana?
Yes. See, there's so much power in people, right? So I'm active with Citizen Science, right? And we have so many apps and games and things on our phones, but we could also be collecting scientific data. And if enough of us are collecting data showing, hey, there's a problem with this power plant that's polluting, we're all showing this data, and we can mobilize action as well. So really, we really do hold power in the palm of our hands right now.
Mm-hmm. George, you want to have the last word on this one?
I don't have much to add. I would definitely say that, I think a lot of it is just word of mouth and making it so that more investors are willing to invest in double bottom line sort of companies that also care about social good. I'll say currently it can be challenging. So, for example, with the startup that I co-founded, our end users, the rural farmers, a lot of them can't pay for the product. So it's kind of like we have to work with them on securing loans and things like that. And so it can be challenging trying to motivate people to move into, do a startup in this kind of space where the end users can't really even pay. And you have to rely on basically getting funding from government getting loans and things like that.
Something called patient capital these days, right? Those that wait a very long horizon if there is a return, if there is a return at all. A rapid fire question. What was your worst subject in school, George?
Chemistry.
Eliana?
History.
Calculus.
Matthew?
English.
History.
Interesting. Okay, Ashley, question for you. So much of your passion and work is about empowering women, youth, and underserved communities. What tools or skills have you found to be most effective in empowering these groups?
So initially, when I decided to start a nonprofit, I just had this idea that just kept coming and it wouldn't disappear. And so I decided to go with the idea, again, the innovative idea, and I started the company, but I actually went to Native women to try to figure out what this organization was going to be about. And so I had a lot of sessions, and what I found was in order to begin to empower Native women, children, and youth, you first need to address the traumas that they had. And so healing has to come before the empowerment actually takes place. And so that was surprising to me because, coming from, being a Stanford graduate, talking about all these incredible ideas, I thought I was going to go out and have all of these amazing vision sessions with Native women, and every single session came back to the idea and notion of healing before you could reach the empowerment phase.
Wow. Okay, Aaron Slamovich from Indiana has a question.
Hi, my name is Aaron Slamovich, and I'm from West Lafayette, Indiana. My question is, innovation in entrepreneurship is oftentimes a game of risk versus reward. How do you choose which risks to take, and which of these risks do you attribute to your success?
Who would like to take that on? Go ahead, Mo.
I would say you never know. That's a very difficult question. We can say there should be another panel next year, risks and rewards. but I think you get better with experience in terms of judging the risks associated to various decisions. But I think what's more important in entrepreneurship is being comfortable in chaos and not worrying too much about the risks, but just moving quickly, because if you keep on moving quickly, then the risks pay off for themselves at the end of the day.
Anyone else?
Yeah. This is more of a general framework for dealing with risk, but putting aside unknown unknowns, which is its own separate class of issues, a really useful thing is to think of which choices are irreversible. So if you're making very risky, irreversible choice, then you spend a lot of time before making that decision, and you basically are much more careful. If it's like a low risk or highly reversible decision, you just take the risk and then you either survive or undo it if you made the wrong choice. So generally speaking, that's sort of what they tell you to do with startups, is like roll the dice, but just if you're rolling the dice on a like bet the entire company thing, try to like minimize slash the number of times you do that. There's only so many miracles you get.
Uliana, let's talk about risk and reward. I mean, you're a mountaineer. Tell me about that.
Yeah,
in terms of the physical aspect of this in your work.
Yeah, and so I like to think of it as a calculated risk. You're constantly making decisions, even if you're not conscious of them. And when you get enough experience in the mountains, you kind of get a feel for the terrain underfoot, the surroundings, and the weather. You kind of become a scientist in multiple ways through your observations in the mountains, meteorology, snow, hydrology, all of it. And you really have to weigh the pros and cons of going up or down and when on mountains, and really learn to read the terrain. And again, that comes with experience, and that's applicable to anything in life. And the more experience that you get, the better read you have on situations.
Anyone else? Okay. I have another rapid-fire question to ask. Who's your favorite scientist or innovator? Mo.
Elon Musk.
Okay. Matthew?
Okay,
Ashley?
Madam Secretary of the Interior, Deborah Holland.
Very cool. Liliana?
Carl Sagan?
Nikola Tesla.
Nikola Tesla, yeah?
Emmy Noether.
Do you want to tell people who?
She's a famous mathematician whose work on symmetries basically underlies most of modern physics.
Right. Very nice. I have a question for you, George. Your day-to-day work is in modeling predictions in healthcare, yet you also founded an agritech company, Cool Crop, that serves farmers in India. How did you end up on that path, and what advice do you have to finalists who worry that they have conflicting passions as they pursue their careers?
I'll just say, as a faculty member, I'm in some sense, I'm kind of like my own boss. No one tells me exactly what I have to do. If you do choose a career path that is in academia, you do have the flexibility to work on a startup on the side, for example. That being said, perhaps if you have, if you're passionate about different things that are, depending on what it is, maybe it can be challenging to do both of them simultaneously. I would just say that's okay. I encourage you to just do what you think will make you feel content. In life, you don't only have to do one thing. You can spend some years doing something, some other years doing something else. I think you shouldn't go. You shouldn't have this feeling of like, oh, I need to choose like one thing and do it for the rest of my life. I'll just say, you have the rest of your life to do a bunch of different things. You don't have to just do one thing.
So I have a question from one of the finalists. Danielle Villafujeta from Puerto Rico.
Hi. Being raised in Puerto Rico and having Peruvian roots, I found myself training for math competitions with peers from different countries. I've had the opportunity to see enormous talents they all have in STEM. However, there's still a big gap in the one some of my peers access. How can we, as young scientists, help reduce that gap and help other young scientists from disadvantaged communities access opportunities like the ISEF and contribute to solve world problems?
We'd like to take that question on. Matthew?
I'll just speak from experience.
Thank you.
So my my background is my mom is from Chile and my dad is from Colombia. And it starts even like within the community. So I remember the way I even got into computer programming is I must have been like 7 or 8 years old and one of my dad's friends just came over and gave me a programming book and like intro to C++. And that's how I got exposed to like programming as a thing. So I think, I mean, that's still very sort of privileged to have that like in the community. But I think, being able to replicate that exposure and being able to like share those opportunities, I just don't know of any specific vehicle. That's like a tough question. It's like, how do you actually get it out into the world and organizations and do that outreach? That's just it's a huge problem, and I just don't know of any organizations off the top of my head that are tackling it.
Society for Sciences, we have a suite of outreach and equity programs that gives grow up. So we have a whole suite from mentorship programs to working with teachers to making sure that all our young people are scientifically literate. So I think, Ashley, you know, you're at the grassroots. You're doing this day in and day out. What's your thought on this?
So both you and Matthew touched upon several words that came up. So talk about privilege. So like understanding your privilege, understanding the privileges that you don't have, and then seeking out people within your community or across the globe who have the privileges that you want or need. And then another thing was mentorship. Also, you know, finding people. I know that I've had several women who've crossed my path who I'm like, oh my gosh, I want them to mentor me. So, you know, working up the courage to reach out to them and ask them to mentor you is definitely important. And then, you know, another thing as far as exposure, you know, reaching out to those of us that have gone through Science Fair or that have resources at different universities, you know, don't be afraid to reach out and ask us for help or reach out to make cold calls, and definitely there's other organizations like the Society for Science that have various programs that support underserved communities of color across the world. So,
I was just gonna say, like, basically, when you graduate high school, go to, you know, college or and grad school or whatnot. You'll probably have opportunities to participate in outreach programs, and I encourage you to do so. When you do have that opportunity, I guess as an example, when I was in grad school, I spent two summers in Jerusalem teaching high school students from Israeli and Palestinian high school students. As is also meant to be a peace initiative sort of thing, and it was very rewarding for me. And I mean, you also get to see like that the students coming from different backgrounds do have access to different resources, and it's good to basically you're there then to essentially try to equalize and give people, you know, equal access to kind of whatever you're teaching.
Anyone else? No.
I think I'm from Egypt, and I was in Egypt during ISEF, but I do believe that the world is becoming a really, really small place. So I learned a lot of the things online. I was able to get a mentor online, and this was back in 12 years ago. I feel super old.
You feel super old.
Yeah. but the world is really becoming a smaller place, and I think our laptops are going to become like this access portal to the world, and slowly, it's not going to matter where you're from, and you're going to be able to access any resource from anyone.
Okay, we have another question from our finalist, Nikolai Zemlyansky from Norway.
Does it work? Yeah. Okay, so my question is, as all of you are very accomplished in your fields, I'm wondering about some of the steps you had to take or the inspiration behind your own company.
Juliana?
Yeah, I think recognizing opportunities where they exist. So I had the opportunity to live abroad in Nepal for a year, and I was doing my scientific research. I was working with local communities, and then I saw a lot of tourists coming through the places where I was working. They had a real interest in the science. So that kind of planted this idea for, maybe I can create a citizen science initiative. Get people who don't understand the science to maybe not become scientists, but understand and appreciate the process of science. Right? There's a science literacy problem in the country, in the world, and so how can we fix that? This might be one pathway to do it. So that was the inspiration for science in the wild, and also more community science, you know, not just citizen science. I like the term community better because it involves not just Westerners going out and doing things, but also connecting with those local communities, which I think is very crucial today.
Anyone else?
In terms of sort of inspiration, so for Open Lattice, it actually grew out of some of the work I did, was doing in my previous startup, where we were working on an information security and homomorphic encryption. And what ended up happening is we started working with a lot of state and local governments because we figured they would have the most sensitive data workflows. And then what we discovered was that that the level of sophistication of the data systems were being used to run like most of our society was just like decades behind like what was available in the private sector. So like the sort of apocryphal story is like Target could tell when someone was pregnant based off their shopping habits, but state and local governments couldn't tell the first thing about you because they have like 20 different databases and none of them talk to each other. So we thought that there was an opportunity to go in there and basically improve how services are delivered and really impact a lot of people in a very direct way and also in a way that like helped preserve privacy and civil liberty, so it didn't turn into some like dystopian like Big Brother thing. So that's what was inspiring for us when we went on that journey.
So I have a rapid fire question. When are you the most productive during the day? George?
Random, but not morning.
Random, but not morning. Good one. Juliana?
I'm a night owl.
Huh?
I'm a night owl.
Night owl.
Same, late at night.
Night?
Yeah, late at night can be early in the morning, but only when it's been a really long night.
And Mo?
Early in the morning.
Early in the morning.
Yeah.
Very interesting. A question for the panelists. How do you deal with rejection or failure? And how have you overcome it? Mo?
You embrace it. You the people that, you know, most often the people that succeed are not the ones that are the luckiest. They're the ones that tried the most. And if you try the most, you're going to fail the most. And that's the mentality. Once you have it helps you kind of streamline the way forward. So embracing failures and knowing that it's a blessing that you failed, because now you know what you did wrong and you have a path to fix it.
Yeah, I would echo what Mo just said. You embrace it and you learn from it. As a personal example, is like when you go raise a round of venture capital, you might have to go, especially if it's your first time doing it, you might have to pitch 60 different VCs, and 59 of them will say no in with varying degrees of harshness. And there's like a very concrete thing of a thing you can do, and an example of learning from failure is every time you get the feedback, they'll say, we didn't invest because of XYZ. And after the first like 10 or 20, you'll start seeing themes emerge. So we kept sort of like an objection list, and then we came up with a way to basically answer every single objection. So we had like a story point whenever it came up so that we could immediately answer it and address it.
Ashley? So when I was thinking about this question, I immediately thought of my science fair project. My project was in the area of microbiology, and I was running all these tests and thinking about all the failures that I would make, and then having to rework, try to figure out what was wrong so that I wouldn't have failures. But as I've gotten older, I began to realize that failures are essential and necessary because they help you to learn. But what has helped me in dealing with the failures is knowing what my core values are. And so really figuring those out at an early age has helped me to withstand the failures and get back up and dust myself off and continue to progress forward.
Yeah. I agree with what's been said already here, but also understanding it's a normal part of life. We're all going to fail and have rejections throughout our lives, so it's normal. And also, if you do get feedback, listening to what that feedback is and reflecting on it, and then adapting and evolving from there.
Sure.
Yeah, I feel like a lot of good answers already. I don't have too much to add. It's definitely learn from your mistakes. I guess as an academic, every faculty member I know of, we're all very used to paper rejections. Like throughout the year, we submit a bunch of papers, a lot of them get rejected, and you have to make sure you learn from your mistakes and learn what things didn't pan out. I can easily say, like, when I was a PhD student, I think every PhD student I know of at some point in their PhD career works on a project that fails. Like, it was dramatic. It's like you have to just, like, let that project go, and that's okay. It's like sometimes, like, you think you have a good idea, but it wasn't as good as you thought, and it's okay, you know, that's also normal and fine, and, you know, you move on. Move on to more promising projects.
Okay, so I have our last question. Can't believe our hour is almost up. To each of you, you know, you were here once, right? And you're back. And how honored we are to have you back. But as you talk to the finalists, and they're going to be talking to you, what is a final piece of advice you have for our finalists today? What would you like, what's that imparting wisdom, guidance that you would like to give anyone?
Never let go of your passion. Just, you know, always stay passionate. Pay bills or ding-a-dingy or whatnot, and you shouldn't let that change your mindset. You should always stay passionate about what you want to do, and you're going to reach great things if you stay passionate.
Liana?
I like John Maxwell's quote, dreams don't work unless you do. And to add on to that, even that's not a guarantee. Even if you work really hard, sometimes those big dreams don't come true, and that's okay. So you should always be following a career path that you are passionate about, that you can see yourself doing, and ideally in service of others as well.
Ashley? So you all are here because of your bright minds. You are light years ahead of your peers. And I remember sitting in your shoes, sitting in those chairs, and having difficulty really believing that my mind was that incredible. It took me a few years to figure out, but like everyone said, you know, continue to believe that your mind is one of the brightest out there. Continue to follow your dreams and your passions, because we truly are relying on you to change the world and the way that technology operates. And so just continue to strive and never give up. George?
Yeah, sure. I guess I would say a couple things. One thing is that really, high school is like it's like the beginning. And, you know, some people might say, like, college is a new high school, grad school is a new college, or maybe some people might say grad school is a new high school. This is just the beginning. So the journey ahead is long. And so already you heard other answers with, like, you know, stay passionate, things like that. Other things I would say here is really because the journey is long, it's not a sprint, it's more of a marathon. Sometimes there are going to be rough patches, and I would definitely encourage you to maintain good friendships. Maintain good friendships. Friendships are going to really help when the going gets rough. And part of this is also, I would encourage you to surround yourself with friends that push you to greater heights in different aspects of life.
Matthew, last word.
All right, so I'm actually going to quote Elon Musk here. So he was having a conversation recently, and he was just saying, like, enjoy life. Because, right, like, why are you doing all these things if you don't enjoy life to some extent, right? Like, it really helps keep that optimism and remind yourself of, like, what's really important and what you're working towards, so it's rooted in something real. And so I think, like, the optimism is super important. It's really easy to fall into, become cynical and be like, oh, things aren't working in society. Look at all these bad things that are happening. And then you become blinded to all the good and incredible work that folks all around the world are doing to move humanity forward. So enjoy life, stay optimistic, believe.
Stay curious, right? Everyone, can we give a big round of applause to them? Thank you, everyone. Stay tuned for the Women in STEM panel next. Thanks.
Thank you, Maya, and thanks to our panelists and to our sponsor, Rise. We'll be back in 30 minutes with the Women in STEM panel beginning at 3:30 p.m. In the meantime, a reminder that some of the panelists you have just met will be available. And we'll see you back here at 3:30 for the Women in STEM panel.